Just over a century ago, on the night from June 14th to June 15th, 1919, Captain John Alcock and Lieutenant Arthur Brown became the first people to fly non-stop across the Atlantic Ocean. Nope, Charles Lindbergh was not the first to cross the Atlantic, he was just the first man to do it alone and non-stop, just in case you were wondering. Competing for a prize of £10,000 offered by the Daily Mail, they flew from St. John's in Newfoundland, Canada, to Clifton in Ireland, a distance of 1,890 miles, in their twin-engined Vickers Vimy biplane. In the past 100 years, saying that a lot has changed would be an understatement. Today, an incredible number of planes cross the Atlantic every single day. Can you guess how many? Leave a comment right now and I'll save the answer for the end of this video, and make sure to stick around until then. Today, we are going to discover how all these planes make it across the vastness that is the North Atlantic every day, on a highway in the sky. Welcome to Airspace. If you've ever opened up an app like Flight Radar 24, you might have noticed the vast number of planes in the sky at a given time. Places such as the continental US or Europe are buzzing like a beehive with planes on seemingly random paths. But when we move our view to the North Atlantic, suddenly we see that planes are flying in perfect order on parallel paths. Why is that? As I said in the intro, a lot has changed since the days of Alcock and Brown and their first non-stop transatlantic crossing. As the jet age dawned and more people wanted to travel between Europe and the US by air, the vast area between the two continents became more and more crowded. Normally, this is not a problem. Air traffic controls are able to process a huge number of flights on crossing routes quite efficiently over land where there is radar coverage. Over the ocean, such an easy provision of separation is not possible due to the lack of radar there. So, way back when, air traffic controls just sent planes over the ocean with vast separations. But as the number of jets over the ocean increased and increased, there was a problem. To separate all these aircraft from one another, air traffic controllers need to be able to determine exactly where these planes are. For that purpose, radars are used where possible. They are really great at detecting the exact positions of all kinds of planes. There's just one problem. Radars send out beams of energy to detect aircraft. Due to the curvature of the Earth, the range of a radar is limited to a theoretical maximum of about 250 miles or 400 kilometers. Beyond that, an aircraft will just vanish behind the horizon of the radar. As you can see, even if there would be radar stations at the very tips of Europe and Canada, this would not be sufficient at all to track all aircraft over the ocean. To solve this problem, the North Atlantic Track System was born in 1961. Its task is to help separate aircraft from one another in places where there is no radar and no conventional VHF radio coverage. Let's see how it works. But first, allow me to introduce today's sponsor, Factor. Factor offers weekly rotating 34 plus meal options or 36 plus add-ons like smoothies, shakes or desserts. If you're busy like me, you'll surely love the fresh, ready-made meals that are delivered to one's doorstep when you sign up with Factor. All of Factor's chef-created meals are fresh, never frozen, and designed by dietitians to ensure every meal is packed with premium, science-backed nutritional quality. With meal preference options like keto, calorie smart, and vegan and vegetarian, a ton of meal options each week, there's something for everyone. Meal plans range from 4 to 18 meals per week, and you can add more or reduce the number depending on your specific needs. You can easily modify food preferences and skip a week if needed. No more meal prep, no more dishes, no more unhealthy fast food. Factor offers the most convenient way to eat well while eating right. Use my link or go to go.factor75.com and use my code FACTORSC43669 for 40% off plus 20% off your next month. Once you click, my description will live update to count up the purchases. Now, let's get back to the North Atlantic, shall we? In general, the North Atlantic upper airspace is divided into six control sectors. Up here, we have Reykjavik Oceanic and Bodø Oceanic, controlled by Norway. In the middle, we have the two most important sectors, Gander Oceanic, controlled by Canada, and Shanwick, controlled by Ireland and the UK. The name Shanwick is in fact a combination of the formerly responsible control areas of Shannon and Prestwick. Lastly, down here are New York Oceanic, of course controlled by the US, and Santa Maria Oceanic, which is controlled from the Azores Island, located down here in the Atlantic. As I said before, the control centers of Shanwick and Gander are the most important ones, since they handle the bulk of the traffic between the US and Europe. Each day, they handle a vast number of planes that usually depart around the same time. Mostly, flights will depart Europe around the later hours of the morning or around lunchtime to arrive in the US in the afternoon. On the other hand, flights in the US will generally depart towards the evening hours in order to arrive in Europe early in the morning. This creates two waves of traffic that need to be handled efficiently. There is just one problem. Usually, most flights would like to take pretty similar routes. This is due to a very strong band of wind called the polar jet stream. It blows in varying strength but in a fixed direction, always from west to east. Therefore, in order to benefit from these nice tailwinds, all flights from the US would like to fly at the core of this jet stream to get to Europe faster, therefore also burning less fuel. On the other hand, flights from Europe would like to avoid the jet stream altogether, while not deviating from their ideal route too far. This usually leaves two desired corridors, one westward and one eastward. But remember, we are talking about a route over an ocean here, where there is no radar. For that scenario, more separation is needed. Therefore, the control centers of Shanwick and Gander create a whole array of tracks for airlines to use each day. One day before a flight intends to cross the Atlantic, airlines have the opportunity to file their preferred routes with the control centers. The centers then publish the so-called track message, in which they publish a set of tracks that planes can use to cross the ocean. The westbound track system consists of multiple tracks named A, B, C, D, and so on. It is usually active from around lunchtime to the early evening hours in Europe, when the bulk of flights heads west. Later, in the early evening hours in the US, the eastbound track system is activated, consisting of tracks named C, Y, X, and so on. All tracks, regardless of whether they are west or eastbound, consist of one of various fixed North Atlantic entry and exit points, with various waypoints in between. The middle part of the route changes every day. There, waypoints are not used in the conventional way, but coordinates are specified at every 10 degrees of longitude. An example track, let's call it track Bravo, could look like this. It begins at waypoint Limbury, then crosses the coordinates of 51 north and 20 degrees west, 49 degrees north, 30 degrees west, 46 degrees north, 40 degrees west, 45 degrees north, 50 degrees west, and ends in Canadian airspace at a waypoint called Raffin. Airlines can choose which track they prefer and file that route in their flight plan. Of course, not all flights can pick the same track at the same altitude, so certain restrictions apply. Later, when a flight finally takes off, it will head towards the oceanic entry point along a route that is still controlled by conventional air traffic control. 90 minutes before reaching the oceanic entry point, a flight will then send a so-called oceanic request message to the oceanic control center in charge. In it, the pilots will once again reconfirm or amend their requested speed and altitude at which they would like to cross the Atlantic. They will also once again confirm the track they would like to use on that day. This is done using CPDLC, or Controller Pilot Data Link Communications, which is sort of a basic messaging system that can send and receive text messages between planes and the ground. The Oceanic Control Center gathers all these requests and tries to figure out how to send planes onto the tracks most efficiently and according to the demands of the pilots. This normally takes anywhere from 1 to 30 minutes. Then, a final clearance for the North Atlantic crossing is sent to the flight. When the clearance finally arrives, the pilots dutifully insert the assigned route into the flight management system and will set their speed according to their clearance. Also, they will have to reach their requested altitude latest before entering the North Atlantic track system. Upon reaching the respective North Atlantic entry point, the previous air traffic controller will hand the flight off to Oceanic Control. From now on, there will no longer be any radar control or VHF communications. Planes will just fly at the altitude and speed they were assigned to, maintaining separation to one another that way. In the early days, pilots would have to report their position at every 10 degrees of longitude, so controllers could intervene if separation between two aircraft would against all expectations be lost. This was done using HF radio, a pretty ancient radio technology that uses radio waves that bounce between the Earth's surface and certain layers of the atmosphere. As you would expect from such a technology, its audio quality is pretty horrible. Listen for yourself. Fortunately, this is not the case anymore. Thanks to satellite communications and surveillance, things are a lot easier today. Planes send their exact position to the oceanic control centers every few seconds via satellite, which makes an exact tracking so much easier. This is also the reason why you can see planes on flight radar while they are crossing the ocean. HF radio is still used, but only as a backup. When crossing into the first, or from one oceanic control center to the next, it has to be checked. Thereafter, no listening watch is required anymore. If a radio operator wants to speak to the pilots of a plane, they can send a special set of tones over the radio, which will trigger a buzzer in the cockpit, indicating that there is a call for them on the HF radio. This is called selective calling, and sounds like this. Also, the advent of GPS and other technologies have made much tighter separation between aircraft possible. In the early days, planes used to be separated by 60 nautical miles laterally, 2,000 feet vertically, and 10 minutes longitudinally. These days, separations of 23 nautical miles laterally, 1,000 feet vertically, and just 5 minutes longitudinally are possible. This enables a much more efficient use of the jet stream, which in turn shortens travel time and increases fuel savings. In the future, even closer spacings between aircraft are planned, which would further improve efficiency. Now, with separations this close and no direct control from a radar station, you might be wondering, what if something goes wrong? What if a plane suffers an engine failure, a fire or decompression, or something else that requires a rapid descent? Luckily, the designers of the North Atlantic track system even thought of that. To give pilots an easy way out, there is a North Atlantic contingency procedure. First, in an emergency, pilots should always attempt to obtain a clearance for a deviation of their route. If that is not possible and an immediate intervention is needed, pilots may exit the track system by turning right or left by at least 30 degrees and then flying offset from the original track by 5 miles. From this position, pilots may descend on a parallel track to an altitude below the organized track system, which typically reaches down to 29,000 feet. There, pilots may exit the track system and tend to their emergency. You see, crossing the North Atlantic is no trivial matter, and still, hundreds of planes do it every day. In 2018, 500,000 planes crossed the Atlantic via the North Atlantic track system, and more are expected to join each year. Now you know everything you need to know about the highway in the sky that is the North Atlantic track system. I hope you found today's video interesting. If you did, make sure to leave a like and subscribe for more interesting aviation content. Thank you so much for watching, and see you in the next video.